Father, we come to you in the mighty name of Jesus. Lord, we're so grateful to come into your house. Lift our hearts, lift our hands to you, God. Lifting our voices in praise and adoration of who you are, God. We just love you so much, God, and we're so thankful for your presence in this place already today. God, we don't want to stop there. We want to go farther. We want to go deeper with you. So we ask, Lord, that today as we open up your word, that you open it up to us. In fact, Lord, open us up to receive it. Open our eyes to see, our ears to hear, our hearts to have a good understanding. May we be the good ground where the word is sown, and may it produce something in each and every one of our individual lives. Father, we acknowledge today we didn't come to hear from a man or a woman, from the young or the old, from the black, the white, the brown, any other color we could imagine. God, we came to hear from you. So Holy Spirit, you are the teacher of the church. Be welcome in this place. Be our teacher. Be our guide. Give us the vision, the wisdom, the instruction, the direction, even the correction we need. The Lord will give you the praise and the glory and the honor for it. God, we don't just ask this blessing upon ourselves. Also, we'd ask it for all the churches, both here in the Inland Empire as well as around the planet. They're our brothers and sisters, Lord, and at no time do we think of ourselves as any better than anybody else, but we see ourselves as co-laborers and workers together in your field, building your kingdom. So God, we ask that you bless the Baptists, Lutherans, Methodists, Episcopalians, Charismatics, Pentecostals, Calvary Chapel. God, we thank you for Harvest, for the Well and the Way, God, for Ecclesia, Trinity, Emmanuel Baptist, God, the Four Square Denominations, Victory, the Assemblies, God, the Catholics. God, we thank you, Lord, for our Seventh-day Adventist brothers and sisters. God, if they're preaching your gospel, lifting up your name, Lord, we bless them as you would bless us today, God. And Lord, also, we don't forget our persecuted brothers and sisters scattered abroad throughout the world. We ask that you encourage them, strengthen them, bless them, guard them, guide them, Lord, that you provide for them and protect them, God, that, Lord, you would deliver them from the hand of their enemies, God, deliver them out of prisons and bondages, God. And Father, we thank you, Lord, that they will endure to the end to the glory of God. Jesus' mighty name, we're all in agreement, and we say,
amen.
Amen. Well, today, get your Bibles out and go with me to the wonderful text of Hebrews, the 11th chapter. Last time we were together, Pastor Luke did a brilliant job ministering the word of God in Hebrews chapter number 11. Today I want to continue those thoughts in Hebrews 11. We're going to be in verse 24 through verse number 26. Hebrews chapter 11, verse number 24 starts out and it says this. It says, by faith. Everybody say, by faith.
By faith.
See, there's no other way you're going to live your life except by faith. In fact, the Bible tells us, Hebrews chapter 11, verse number 6, it's impossible to please God unless you're living by faith. Can't even be pleasing to God except by faith. So as we read through Hebrews 11 chapter, every time you read those two little words, by faith, understand that this is the way to live life. That as you see what the people who have gone before us did, and you see the fathers and the mothers of the faith, the great men and women that God uses as examples for us in his word, that we can model their faith and we can get the same results that they got. So today we read, and it says, by faith, Moses, when he became of age, refused to be called the son of Pharaoh's daughter. Now, if you read in the book of Acts, you'll find out that he was about 40 years old, but really it wasn't about a number. This wasn't about 40 years old. No, it was really about maturity. In other words, there came a moment where Moses crossed over in faith, and he matured to the point where he no longer looked at being esteemed and being connected with Pharaoh's daughter any longer, even though she had raised him, and that was wonderful. Even though he knew that he was a Hebrew being raised up. But now he decided he was going to cut those ties and he was going to be identified with the people of God. Look at what it says in verse number 25. Choosing rather to suffer affliction with the people of God than to enjoy the passing pleasures of sin. Now don't you know there is a pleasure that is associated with sin? And we could choose in our lives to say, hey, you know what? I'm really going to enjoy myself right now. God, you do you. I'm going to do me right now. And yet, here's Moses leaving us an example that he would rather suffer affliction than enjoy the passing pleasure of sin. See, we see people in the Bible that decided they made the wrong choice, like Esau, right? He decided to take hold of the passing pleasure of a full belly full of lentil soup rather than to have the blessing of God upon him. And he cried out for it later with tears. We see Gehazi, right? Who chose to have fine apparel and gold and prestige rather than to be humble and to be a servant of the great prophet. And he went out from the prophet's presence, white as snow with leprosy. We see in the New Testament, Ananias and Sapphira who were looking towards the praises of man and wanting to look like they were something when they really weren't. And Barnabas had came and he had laid down the piece of property at a price and he laid that down at the apostles' feet. And then here comes Ananias and Sapphira doing the same thing, trying to look like big shots. And yet they held back part of the proceeds and they lied about it. They covered it up, and they lied in the presence of the apostles, and both of them fell dead before the apostles. See, there is a passing pleasure. There is that joy. There is that excitement. There's those things. And yet, when you look at the results, none of us would want to touch that, not even with a 10-foot pole. Bible says, hating even the garment that is stained by sin. Now look at what it says in verse number 26. This is how Moses was able to do this. How did he look past the pleasure of sin? How did he look past all the riches and the prestige of Egypt and of Pharaoh's house? Here's how. Look at what it says in verse 26. Esteeming the reproach of Christ. Greater riches than the treasures in Egypt. For he looked to the reward. He looked past the temporary, and he looked to the eternal, and he saw what really had value, and he esteemed the reproach of Christ. Today, the message title, if you're taking notes, is Esteeming His Reproach. Esteeming His Reproach. Now, I know we don't talk in these terms. You know, this is not really words that we would use that often, and yet we need to define them so that we understand where we're going today. When we talk about esteeming something, many of you would think, well, that's like respecting someone, right? Our esteemed guest, or, you know, I really have a high esteem for what you do. So really, that's talking about respect, right? Well, yes, you could say that. And even in this context, we could say that that's part of what it is. But really, when I dug in to find out about this word esteeming, I found out that there's another word that I could associate it with that better explains it for each and every one of us. Let's say you had a piece of property. You had a house, right? And you wanted to sell that house for a certain price. And so as you got into the negotiations and somebody says they want to put in an offer, what happens? Now you go to escrow and they have to do something, right? They have to order an appraisal. Now an appraiser comes out and he takes a look at the area. He looks at, the square footage. He looks at the lot size. He looks at the fixtures. He looks at the add-ons. He looks at all the different features of the house. He's looking at what type of floors you have. Are they wood floors? Are they carpet floors? You know, do they have single pane windows, double paned windows? What's the school district? They look at all this stuff. They add it all up and they place a value on that home. When we talk about esteeming his reproach, really what we're talking about is that we're ordering an appraisal. We're taking a look at the value. We're adding up all the details. We're looking at everything that's involved. And now that we see the whole picture, now we can place a value in our lives on the reproach of Christ. You say, that's great, Pastor, but what are we talking about here? What's reproach? I haven't really asked anybody, have you been reproached lately? You know, that's not stuff that we say to each other. So what is a reproach? Well, really, it's a reviling. How about this? Talking about you behind your back. Mm-hmm. Now we know what we're talking about, right? Maybe you've been reproached in your life. Maybe somebody's called you a name because you were a Christian. How about this one? Bible thumper. Mm-hmm. Holy roller. Some of you guys been called that? Or simply this, you can hear it in their condescending tone, you Christians. I know I've been called that. Wow. You didn't even realize it, but you were suffering reproach at that moment. Somebody was speaking bad about you, talking about you. Maybe they were snickering and making play. They were making fun of you over there at the water cooler when you walked by. And all of a sudden, they all got quiet and kind of looked over. And then once you walked by, you noticed they started laughing again. See, each and every day, we go through trials. And if we're living our lives for Jesus, then we are going to suffer. The Bible promises it to us. You can't get away from it. Jesus said, in the world, you have trouble. My God, those aren't good promises, Lord. I don't want that promise. And yet God says it's coming to your life, so we need to know how to handle it. We need to know what it is. We need to add up all the facts, order an appraisal, and take a look at what it is, and then place value on it. Because here's Moses, and Moses was able to esteem the reproach of Christ as greater riches than the treasures in Egypt, for he looked to the reward. So how do we do this? How do we esteem the reproach of Christ? Well, it's very simple. I just gave the answer to you in the verse. What he did was that he added up the eternal value. For each and every one of us, it's that simple. If you're going to esteem the reproach of Christ, then all you got to do is you got to add up the eternal value. Well, what does that mean? That means that you take a look at all the facts and you take a look at, is this really something that I need to have? Do I need to have the approval and the praise of man? Do I really need to have the riches and the wealth of this world? Or can I choose to suffer looking to eternity? Just add up the eternal value. Let me show it to you in the Word of God. You're there in Hebrews 11. Turn one page back to Hebrews chapter 10. We were there in Hebrews chapter 10 probably about a year ago. Maybe you can check your notes and find out when that was. Hebrews chapter 10, we're going to be in three verses. We're going to start in verse number 32, and we're going to read through verse number 34. Hebrews chapter 10, verse 32 starts out like this. It says, "But recall the former days in which after you were illuminated, you endured a great struggle with sufferings." Some of you guys in this room encountered that. When you got saved, the bottom just fell out, it seemed like. You thought that you were signing up for something good, and all of a sudden everybody hated you. Your family turned their backs on you. All of your friends started hating on you. They started lying about you, talking about you. They said that you were crazy. They never had any input into your life about your finances and about you going to the bar or to the club or spending your money on alcohol and drugs. But the moment you started giving money to church, now all of a sudden everybody has a discussion about it at the Thanksgiving table, right? And you're wondering, what's going on, man? This is crazy. And maybe some of you in this room said this. You might have said, man, it would have been better for me to stay a sinner if I'd have known all this pain and all this stuff was going to happen to me. But he says you endured. Recall those days. Remember those days. Remember the trials you went through. Remember how people hated you. Remember how people lied on you. Remember what you endured and the cost that you paid to become a Christian. He goes on and he says in verse number 33, "Partly while you were made a spectacle, both by reproaches," remember we're talking about esteeming the reproach, "both by reproaches, people talking on you, lying on you, slandering you, using your name as a curse word or as a byword, both by reproaches and tribulations," the trials and the troubles that you go through, "and partly while you became companions of those who were so treated." Maybe you didn't have that experience. I know when I got saved, it was like everything changed, man. The sun shining through the windows was brighter. The birds were chirping louder. Even the smog in Moreno Valley smelled better when I got saved. I don't know what happened. I just, man. Loved it. But you know what? You chose to suffer with others. When you saw people were getting lied on, when you saw people that were trying to do something for God and they were returned evil for the good that they were doing, you went over and you lifted them up. You said, "Let me pray for you, brother. Let me hold you up, sister. You know what? Hey, it doesn't matter if everybody walks out on you. I'm walking in and I'm going to hold up your hands. I'm going to hold up your arms. You can do it. You can take it. I don't care what they think about me. I'm coming over here and I'm going to associate with you." See, look at what he says in verse 34, "For you had compassion on me and my chains and joyfully accepted the plundering of your goods." Why would someone do that? You're going to take away my stuff? Wait, you're going to come and remove the things that I worked hard for? Why would someone do this? Here's why. Look at the next word, knowing. In other words, when they were going through these trials, when they were going through these sufferings, they called for an appraisal. And they found out all the facts, knowing that you have a better and an enduring possession for yourselves in heaven. I don't have my eyes on the here and now. I don't have my eyes on the natural things. I don't have my eyes on the passing pleasures of sin. I don't care if people like me. I don't care if I have the best stuff here on the earth. I don't care what you're going to do to me. You can slap me on this side. I'll turn the other cheek. You can ask for my coat. I'll give you my shoes also. You ask me to go a mile, I'm going to go to the second mile. Why? Because it doesn't matter about here on the earth, the here and now. That's passing. That's temporary. That's all going to burn. But listen, I'm looking. I've ordered an appraisal. I've added up the facts, and now I know that there's something better and more enduring for me in heaven. So then what's the reward? Remember, we talked about adding up all the facts. Did you know that there is a reward? When we order that appraisal, when we start to look at that, and when we start to bear the reproach, what is the reward? You know, God is into incentives. Sometimes people get mad at the preacher and say, "Oh, you guys, you always have to tell us about blessings and incentives. We shouldn't be motivated by incentives. We should just love God and do it just because we love God." I would say a big amen. I wish that was the case. But do you think God knows that we are motivated by incentives? Of course he does. God made us that way. How do I know that? Because God wouldn't have put him in his word if he didn't make it that way, right? See, I didn't write this. God wrote this. God's the one that put this in place, and he knew that if we were just going day to day, and we love the Lord, and yes, it should be this way, but it's not. Because why? We're fickle creatures, aren't we? We still are warring in the spirit against the flesh. And if day after day after day after day, all it was reproach and trouble and trial and suffering and tribulation, and we didn't have any rewards or anything to look forward to, we would lose hope and we would give up. Okay, none of y'all would, but I know I would. All right? Can the preacher be honest in this place? Maybe you're the same way. And yet God says there are rewards. I want to let you know so that you don't lose hope and so that you don't give up. When you know there's a reward, you say, well, I can endure some temporary pain. I can go through the trial. I can go through the problem. I can go through the process. Why? Because there's a reward waiting for me on the other side. Amen. It's okay to clap. It's all right. It's good. It's good for you. Okay? Because now you know it's good. So what are the rewards? We see that God lays out some incentives for us, that if we will esteem his reproach, we will order that appraisal, add up all the facts, and now enter into it with him. Now there's a reward. What are the rewards? First one is this, blessing. Blessing. God will bless your life when you bear the reproach of Christ. When you share in his suffering. The Bible says, in fact, if we share in his sufferings, that we will also share in his glory. Wow. That's pretty amazing. Luke chapter 6, if you want to turn there with me. Luke chapter number 6, we're going to go to a very familiar section of verses. Maybe you're more familiar with them in Matthew. But in Luke chapter 6, we find the Beatitudes. The word beati in the Latin means this, blessed. Hello? Come on, somebody, you know you want to be blessed. Don't lie in church. Beati, blessed. The Beatitudes, that you are blessed when certain things happen in your life. And let's see what Jesus says in Luke, the 6th chapter, verse number 22 and verse number 23. Jesus is speaking. These are, if you have a red letter Bible edition, these are the words of Jesus in red. And look at what it says. It says, blessed. Everybody say blessed.
Blessed.
Oh, come on, everybody. Say it like you mean it. Blessed.
Blessed
who? Blessed are you when men hate you. Whoa, wait a second. Time out. That's not a blessing. That's a curse. I don't want that blessing. But Jesus says, blessed. See, it doesn't make sense to the natural mind, does it? That's not blessing, God. You're crazy. People hate you and that's blessed. No, that's not blessed. I don't like that. But let's read on. Look at what it says. And when they exclude you, wait a second. God, this is going from bad to worse. What's this all about, God? They exclude me. I don't want to be lonely. I don't want to be left out. I don't want to be on the outside. I want to be on the inside. No, you're blessed when men hate you. You're blessed when they exclude you and revile you and cast out your name as evil. God, you got to be crazy. God, this is not blessed. This is a bad day. God, this is not right. What are you doing here? Look at what he says. Look at what he says. For the Son of Man's sake. See, not for your sake, but for his sake. He says you're blessed when you do it on his behalf. Why? Because you ordered the appraisal, you've added up all the facts, and now you know something about God, and you look to the reward that there's a blessing coming. Look at what it says in verse 23. Rejoice in that day and leap for joy. You know what that looks like? You're over there at the water cooler, and you start talking to someone about Jesus. They say, hold on one second. They take the whole water thing, and they just dump it over your head, and you are standing there all wet and wondering what's going on, and you just start laughing. You just start smiling. You got a little pep in your step. You know, you got a little glide in your stride all of a sudden. Why? Because now you are blessed. Maybe they take the coffee pot, right, and they pour it down your back. Woo! I'm blessed. I'm blessed. Why? For his sake, not for my sake. Because now I'm sharing in his sufferings. Look what it says, rejoice in that day and leap for joy, for indeed your reward. Remember, I didn't write this. This is God speaking. There is a reward. Here's your incentive. For indeed your reward is great in heaven. For in like manner, their fathers did to the prophets. You know what that means? That means that you are in good company when you are suffering for the name of Jesus. Because that's how they treated Jeremiah. That's how they treated Ezekiel. Oh, you are bumping elbows with the best of them now. That's how they treated Isaiah. And guess what? That's how they treated Jesus. You're in good company when you're suffering reproach for the name of Jesus. You are blessed. Well, what are the other incentives? How about this one? I like this one. When you add up the facts, what's the rewards? Well, the second thing that we see is this. The reward is God's presence and glory. God's presence and glory. If ever you felt far away from God, if ever you felt like you were praying and your prayers were hitting the roof and bouncing back, and you wonder, where's God at? Go out and start to tell someone about Jesus. God will meet you in that place. And if you start to bear his reproach, and people start talking about you, people start getting huffy, people start getting mad. Sometimes it's the people who call themselves Christians. The religious spirit raises up his head. Well, you shouldn't be telling people about Jesus, you know. Oh, my goodness, what's that all about? Well, now you're bearing his reproach. God is right there. 1 Peter chapter 4, let me show it to you in the Word. 1 Peter chapter number 4, right past Hebrews. You'll find James. Right after James, you'll find 1 Peter. 1 Peter, go to the 4th chapter and verse number 14. 1 Peter chapter 4. In fact, if you're suffering, you're going through something right now, some of you guys are going through some trials, just read all of 1 Peter. Specifically, lock into what it says in verse number 4 and in, chapter number 4, and then chapter number 5 has some things to say, some encouragement and some hope for you. But 1 Peter chapter 4 talks specifically about suffering for his name versus suffering because you did something wrong. You did something wrong, that's on you. But if you're suffering for his name, now you have the presence of God, and now you have his glory. Verse 14, 1 Peter chapter 4 says, if you are reproached. Remember, we're talking about bearing his reproach, esteeming it. Then we're adding up the facts. So he says, if you are reproached for the name of Christ, blessed are you. We already saw that, right? We're blessed. Why? For the spirit of glory and of God rests upon you. When somebody's yelling at you, when somebody's mad at you, when somebody's talking about you, now the spirit of God rests upon you. Now look at what it says. On their part, he is blasphemed, but on your part, he is glorified. You know what that word glorified means? It means that you are displaying the goodness of God. His glory is his manifested goodness. It's God's goodness on display. So when you start to suffer, when you start to bear his reproach, when people start to talk about you, when you go through sufferings on his behalf, not on your behalf, on his behalf, now all of a sudden you start to show the goodness of God. Instead of John Wesley, many of you guys know that name. He was one of the founders of the Methodist movement. In fact, he traveled 4,000 miles every year in the 1700s. Now, maybe you don't understand that, but that wasn't driving a car or flying. That wasn't air miles. That was huffing it. That was on 2 feet or on a horseback. In his lifetime, it said that he preached some 400,000 sermons. He's an amazing man. But because of his outspokenness, because of his preaching, because of his missions that he did there in England, people got mad at him. They did not like him. They would see him coming and they'd go get some eggs. And they'd start chucking eggs at him. Hey, preacher, get out of here, right? Throwing eggs and stuff at him. Some of them actually got violent and started to throw rocks and bricks at him. Now, oftentimes when he was traveling, he would have to watch where he was going. But he was a very effective man for the kingdom of God. It's said that one day he was traveling and it dawned on him, man, no one's thrown anything at me in like 3 days. And he stopped everything and he got down on his knees before God and he started to pray and he said, Lord, what's wrong? Have I done something, God, to offend you? God, have I backslidden? I mean, no one's persecuting me, God. Why have you backed off of me? And while he was praying, there's a good sinner across the way that saw him and said, I think that's the preacher. And he went and he grabbed a brick and he lobbed it at him. Now, thankfully, the brick missed. And Wesley realized what happened and he jumped up to his feet and he said, oh, thank God, I still have your presence. See, when you're reviled, when you're reproached, when you go through trials and sufferings, now Jesus is right there with you in the midst of it. What is the reward? How do we esteem the reproach? We add up the value. We add up the eternal value. So what is the reward? First is blessing. Second is God's presence and God's glory. And the third one is this, God's strength. God's strength. Oh, don't we need the strength of God? Every day we need God's strength. And if you need God's strength, then all you got to do is put yourself in a position to receive. In the book of 2 Corinthians, if you want to turn there with me, 2 Corinthians chapter number 12, very familiar section of scripture when talking about the strength of God, because the Apostle Paul, man who did mighty things in the kingdom of God, a man who went through a lot of stuff, a lot of trials, here he was, and the Bible says that he had a messenger of Satan coming against him. There was a demonic thing that he called a thorn in the flesh. I believe it was the persecutions coming at him again and again. Here he is in Lystra, and here comes the Jews. Here he is in Derbe, and they go find him there. Here he is, and he's going out to Iconium, and there they follow him there. There's riots breaking out in Ephesus. He's snake bit. He's shipwrecked. He's going through all sorts of trials, and this buffeting thing, this messenger of Satan just keeps coming against him. Everywhere he goes, here's the devil trying to stop his efforts, and it's just coming after him and after him and after him. Persecution, trials, beatings, mockings, scourgings. People are lying about him. They're saying that he's just after financial gain. They're saying all sorts of stuff about him behind his back. And he gets fed up, and finally he goes before the Lord and he does what you and I would have done. He starts crying, bawling and squalling. Lord, I don't understand. What's this all about? I've said in the name of Jesus, I tried to pray, and God, I want you to just take this thorn away from me, God. Remove this thorn in the flesh. And the Lord denies him three times. God's response is this: my grace is sufficient for you. In other words, I'm not going to remove the trial from you, but rather I'm going to take you through it. My grace is sufficient for you. Now, how do we define grace in this church? If you know it, say it with me: grace, God's sovereign, divine ability to get the job done on my behalf when I can't do it. Let's say that again: grace, God's sovereign, divine ability to get the job done on my behalf when I can't do it. So he says, my grace is sufficient for you. Now, what are we talking about? We're talking about God's strength is upon us when we bear the reproach of Christ. Look at it with me. 2 Corinthians chapter 12, verse number 10. Because of this, he says, therefore, I take pleasure in infirmities, in reproaches, in needs, in persecutions, in distresses for Christ's sake. Not for his sake, not for our sake, but for Christ's sake. Look at this last sentence. He says, for when I am weak, then I am strong. Maybe you came into this place today feeling weak, feeling like you couldn't do anything for God, feeling like a failure because everybody you talked to about Jesus, everybody you handed a card to invite him to church, everybody that you went out to minister to has all turned their backs, lied about you, talked about you. They have cast you out. They have used your name as a curse word. And yet, if you are weak in this place, I've got good news for you. You are in pole position to receive the strength of God in your life. Hallelujah. That's good news. Bill Hybels writes in his book, Too Busy Not to Pray, and he says, a couple of years ago, a member of my church's vocal team and I were invited by a Christian leader named Yesu to go to southern India. There we would join a team of people from various parts of the U.S. We were told that God would use us to reach Muslims and Hindus and non-religious people for Christ. We all felt called by God to go, but none of us knew what to expect. When we arrived, Yesu met us and invited us to his home. Over the course of the next few days, he told us about his ministry. Yesu's father, a dynamic leader and speaker, had started the mission in a Hindu-dominated area. One day, a Hindu leader came to Yesu's father and asked for prayer. Eager to pray with him, hoping he would lead him to Christ, he took him into a private room, knelt down with him, closed his eyes, and began to pray. While he was praying, the Hindu man reached into his robe, pulled out a knife, and stabbed him repeatedly. Yesu, hearing his father's screams, ran to help him. He held him in his arms as blood poured out onto the floor of the hut. 3 days later, his father died. On his deathbed, he said this to his son. Now, what are we talking about? Okay, I want to make sure you get the point today. We're talking about esteeming the reproach of Christ, adding up all the facts, ordering that appraisal, and then coming to a conclusion about the value of the sufferings of Christ. Talking about that there are rewards when we suffer with Christ. And one of them is the strength of God. I want you to listen to the strength that God gave Yesu's father. This is what he said to Yesu on his deathbed. He said, please tell that man that he is forgiven. What kind of strength does it take to forgive the man that stabbed you to death? What kind of strength does it take to forgive somebody who only meant you evil? See, only Jesus on the cross models that strength when he says, Father, forgive them, for they do not know what they do. And now he can give that same strength to us when we are persecuted in times of need. Please tell that man that he's forgiven. Care for your mother and carry on this ministry. Do whatever it takes to win people to Christ. See, that's the strength of God right there. When you are weak, he is strong. I want to end with an encouragement from the Word of God, Isaiah chapter 51. Turn there with me. Because now that we know what it is, now that we know how to do it, we also know the rewards, I want you to listen to the Word of God for each and every one of us. Isaiah chapter 51. Take a look at verse number 7 and verse number 8. Isaiah chapter 1, verse 51, verse number 7. God is speaking and he says, listen to me, you who know righteousness. That's us, isn't it? We've been trained all our lives with the Word of God. From a young age, we've known Bible stories. But I submit to you what John Maxwell said in one of his messages. He said, we are far more educated beyond our obedience. So God is speaking. He says, listen to me, you who know righteousness, you people in whose heart is my law. Now I know he's talking to believers. Because God says that I will remove the heart of flesh, and I will remove the heart of stone, and I will put in a heart of flesh, and I will write my law on your hearts. God is speaking to us today, here and now. Look at what he says. Do not fear the reproach of men. Maybe today as you heard the Word of God, you started to get a little nervous. Starting to get a little edgy in your seat. Well, Pastor, I don't know if I can endure. I don't know if I can handle that. I don't know if I'm strong enough. I don't know. I don't really like it when people talk bad about me. You know, I really like it when people like me. You know, I want to win them to the Lord. Don't they need to like me in order to trust me to speak the word into them? But Jesus said that no man is greater than his master, and if they persecuted me, they will persecute you also. And the Bible tells us that all that want to live a godly life in Christ Jesus will be persecuted. It's going to happen. Not everyone's going to like you, and that's okay. Because even the Apostle Paul, who hated Christians and was breathing out threats and was persecuting them and dragging them out of their homes and putting them in prison, even he fell down at the feet of Jesus. So just because someone says no to you doesn't mean that the story is over. But you have to endure the persecutions for his sake. So he says, do not fear the reproach of men, nor be afraid of their insults. How can I do that, God? How can I go through it, Lord? Look at the next verse. For the moth will eat them up like a garment, and the worm will eat them like wood. But my righteousness will be forever, and my salvation from generation to generation. See, God is saying, I will hold you together. I will keep you tight. I will make sure that you can go through every trial. My grace is sufficient for you. You don't have to worry about what's going to happen to them. I will take care of them. At the end of all things, I'll add it all up, and I will cancel every debt, and I will repay, says the Lord. But you just hold on to me, and you add up the eternal value, and you bear my reproach for the name of Jesus. Dr. Bob Moorhead writes, in 1980, a young man from Rwanda was forced by his tribe to either renounce Christ or face certain death. He refused to renounce Christ, and he was killed on the spot. The night before, he had written the following commitment, which was found in his room. I am a part of the fellowship of the unashamed. The die has been cast. I've stepped over the line. The decision has been made. I am a disciple of Jesus Christ. I won't look back. Let up, slow down, back away, or be still. My past is redeemed. My presence makes sense. My future is secure. I am finished and done with low living, sight walking, smooth knees, colorless dreams, tamed vision, worldly talking, cheap giving, and dwarfed goals. My face is set. My gate is fast. My goal is heaven. My road is narrow. My way is rough. My companions are few, but my guide is reliable. My mission is clear. I won't give up, shut up, let up until I have stayed up, stored up, prayed up for the cause of Jesus Christ. I must go till he comes, give till I drop, preach till everyone knows, work till he stops me, and when he comes for his own, he will have no problem recognizing me because my banner will have been clear. Hallelujah! We are a part of the fellowship of the unashamed. I am not ashamed of the gospel of Jesus Christ, for it is the power of God unto salvation for all who believe. Add up the facts, order the appraisal, and find out the weight of the value of the reproach of Christ. Live it out each and every day. Don't worry about what people are going to say. Listen, worry about what God's going to say. We live to please Him, and it can only be done by faith. It comes when you have a maturity, when Moses became of age. And now today you have the Word of God. You have the wisdom of God. You know His righteousness. Don't be afraid of their insults. Don't fear when men reproach you for His name's sake. There's a blessing. There's His presence and His glory. His goodness will be displayed through you, and His strength will be given to you.